As we open God's Word this morning, we are continuing in this sermon series with a number of themes that we have been focusing on for the past couple of weeks, and we'll be continuing to do so for the next while. Belong, Believe, Become, we're calling this sermon series. And we've been focusing specifically in on the belong portion of this series, and we've been talking about that over the last couple of weeks. So if you were here, remember with me. If you weren't, a little bit of a catch-up. We began by talking about Scripture's language of belonging. We read Ephesians chapter 1 and 2. We talked through a number of words that are specifically used there to talk about how we belong, especially when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, that we belong in the family of God. And Scripture uses words like adopted, chosen, accepted, seated, even seated with Jesus at the right hand of God, that the gospel of Jesus Christ doesn't begin with a big do. You don't have to do a lot to get in there. You don't have to do anything to get in there except believe in Jesus. But it begins with an eternal done. An eternal done. That Jesus Christ has done it for us. And because of that, we are accepted. We are chosen. We are adopted. We are blessed. We are forgiven. We are welcome in God's family. This is the language of belonging that we've been talking about. And then we talked a little bit more about that, about how God's posture is one of open arms. Open arms. And we looked at the narrative of Jesus beckoning the children to come. Right? Jesus is doing ministry and the children are there and people are bringing children and the disciples are trying to stop these parents. Like, no. Jesus is too important, too busy for these kids. But Jesus says, no, let the children come to me. Let the children come. That this is the posture that God takes, a posture of open arms, welcoming and belonging in the family of God. And we talked about how the Bible calls us God's children. Let the children come to me. We are God's children. We are chosen. We are adopted. We are welcomed into God's family. We also talked last week about at the beginning of the parable that we're going to continue reading this week. Last week we read the first two parts of that, the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, and we see that not only does God stand with open arms welcoming people in, wherever you are, wherever you come from, God says, come to me. Come to me, you who are weary, Scripture says, and I will give you rest. Not only does he stand with open arms, but he also goes out and looks for the lost. He goes out to find them. The one sheep that leaves the flock of 100, right? There's 99 sheep, and he leaves the 99, the shepherd does, and goes out and finds the one. That's what God does. He's always looking, always waiting, always watching, vigilant to find those who are lost. Because everyone belongs in the family of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. All people belong in God's family. And God will go to extraordinary lengths to find the lost sheep. And so this morning we're going to continue with this parable. This is a set of three stories that are all kind of combined into one parable. This parable, it may be familiar to you. It's called the parable of the prodigal son. Or if prodigal isn't a word that's familiar to you, a parable of the lost son, the wayward son, the rebel, we could say even. So I invite you to open your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. If you don't have a Bible with you, that's okay. No worries. We have some underneath the seats in front of you. You're welcome to use those. Or the words are going to be on the screen too, and you are welcome to follow along there, however best you can engage the Word this morning. Luke chapter 15, starting at verse 11. Listen for the Word of the Lord. Jesus continued, "There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, 'Father, give me my share of the estate.' So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all that he had. He set off for a distant country, and there he squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son and threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He is lost and is found.' And so they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of his servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied. 'Your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill a fattened calf for him?' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead, and he is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we're going to look at each of these three characters quickly and talk about these themes that we've been working with and talking about, and how they inform us as a church, how they inform the posture of this church, Hopkins Community Church, and the people that form this community of faith. So let's talk about the father first. This father had two sons. Notice right off the bat that the two individuals are labeled as sons. And no matter what happens, they don't ever lose that identity. Not for lack of trying, mind you. Because these sons, right, they are his sons. But the one son asked for his inheritance, which essentially means he said, "Dad, I wish you were dead. Give me what you owe me by the law. I wish you were dead. I want it now." Now, in our culture, and definitely in Hebrew culture, that is grounds enough for disavowment, for abandonment. You are no longer my son anymore. You take what you get, and you get out of here. Because you wish I was dead? Well, I don't need you anymore. It's a pretty normal, I think, response. Somebody wishes we were dead. We don't have a lot of love for them. I mean, I don't think that I would. I can't imagine somebody wishing me dead. I can't imagine me having a lot of love for that person, a lot of caring for them. "Well, you wish I was dead. I don't have a lot of use for you either." But that's what happens. But the sons, they never lose that identity. They always belong to the father. They are always and continually the father's sons. And the father never stops longing, never stops waiting, never stops looking for the lost son. And he says, "I am always with you. You're always with me. All I have is yours," to the older son. The father's love is continual, always, always being poured out for his kids. And he never stops looking either, right? If the son is coming home and the father sees him a long way off, this isn't just a chance like he's going out to his field and he looks, he's like, "Whoa, the son's coming home." He was looking. The language there is that the father is looking, always longing, desiring. Maybe he may even be leaving the house, going out into the different towns, looking for his lost son. And while he was a long way off, the father does the most undignified thing a Jewish man can do. He runs. He runs to his son, full of compassion and love for his son. It's a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful image. You know, think about the movies, right? It's that slow motion run. The daisies are popping up all over the place, and everybody's smiling and happy. Just kidding. But it's kind of, that's the image that we're getting. It's a very similar thing. This full of compassion, arms wide open, embrace of his son, despite everything that he did. The father never lost hope. There was never a point where that son wasn't welcome. Do you hear those same themes that are popping up again? This language of belonging and identity, this posture of acceptance and love, and the fact that the son, or that the father, is always searching. And there's a younger son. He's a little wayward, maybe a little bit rebellious. I had a younger brother. He was kind of like that. You know, maybe this younger son maybe had a tattoo or something like that. Maybe, you know, maybe, I don't know. There's nothing wrong with tattoos. I'm not saying that. Just, you know, he kind of fits the stereotypes of what we would see as maybe a little bit more rebellious. And he loses himself in this kind of personal quest to find himself, maybe. Maybe that's kind of the idea. He goes out to find himself and loses himself in that quest. But there's specific language that's used to talk about the younger son. And it's specific because of the context that Jesus is in. Remember, or if you were here last week and you remember this, if not, remember or just understand the context that Jesus is in is that he is teaching, and he's teaching tax collectors and sinners. Those are the people that have gathered around to hear Jesus. And then there's also Pharisees and teachers of the law, the religious elite. And and Scripture says right in 15 verse 1 and 2 that they're standing back and they're muttering, they're talking about, they're gossiping with each other about who Jesus is talking to. And Jesus uses specific language in this parable to relate this younger brother as a sinner and someone that's being under the law and what he has to do to get back to not being a sinner, to being right with his father again. There's specific language to talk about the sin, obviously, that he does, that he squanders his wealth, he does all of that. There's specific language to talk about the enslavement of sin, right? He has to hire himself out to do work. He has to, and when he decides to go back to his father, he decides, you know, he's like, well, I'll just be a servant of my father. I'm not worthy to be called a son. And he's using the specific language because it's law-related language. The Pharisees would resonate with this, right? The Pharisees would say, well, yeah, of course he doesn't belong in that family anymore. He should be a servant. He's got to work his way back into his father's good graces. That's what the law would say. And there's a really interesting part of this is the fact that the younger son, he's degraded so much to be made, like, he's like, so unclean in the law because he's working with pigs. Pigs are like the most disgusting animal in the Jewish culture. You can't eat them. You can't associate with them. They're bad news, right? And that's what the younger son has to do. He has to feed the pigs. He has to feed the most unclean thing that you could possibly have in your culture. That's his job. And he wants that food, and he can't even have that. So there's this specific language to talk about sin and law and what repentance looks like to the Pharisees. You have to work your way back in. But the reality is that the repentance that Jesus is talking about at the beginning here is not possible. There is nothing that this son could do to make up for what he did. There is no way that he could repay what he has done. It has to be forgiveness. It has to be forgiveness that comes from the Father. This is, in essence, the gospel in this short, small couple of sentences. We've sinned. We're sinful. We've all gone astray. Scripture says that you were once among them, dead in your transgressions and sins. That's what Ephesians says. But because of God's grace, because of his great love for us, you have been forgiven. It's by grace you have been saved. This is the gospel right here. The Father's forgiveness is the gospel message right here and now. We really like to associate ourselves with that too, right? That's a pretty easy connection that we make. Yes, I am the younger son. I was born in sin. I'm a sinful person. But because of God's grace, I'm welcome into God's family. That's a really easy connection for us to make, right? Done. Parable over. We're all set. We can go home now. But there's another son. There's an older son. What do we often think about him? At the beginning of the parable, we think, the older son, he's pretty silent in there, but he doesn't leave his father. He says he's a hard worker, he's loyal, he's committed to his father. And you get to the end, the Pharisees at that point are probably thinking to themselves, tighten up your tie a little bit, stand up a little bit straighter. Committed to the father, I'm always there, I'm working hard. And then you get to the end of the parable, and what do we think about the older son? He's jealous. Self-interested, selfish, unloving. See, Jewish custom would have charged the older son as a mediator between the younger son and the father. And his silence screams volumes about his true intentions. He doesn't say anything when the younger son leaves. And we say, well, he's just working hard. Yeah, well, he is just working hard. But what is he actually working for? It's pretty clear that the older son didn't share the father's heart. He wasn't standing there looking with the father waiting. He wasn't going out into the villages and looking for this younger son. He was what? He was working hard. And if he actually shared the father's heart, or at the very least, if he was kind of neutral in the whole situation, then when the younger son came home, he'd be like, oh, good. Well, that's good. I better get back to work. At the very least, that's what we would expect from this older son. A kind of content-neutral reaction. But he's not that way. And his reaction reveals his heart very clearly. He's angry. How many of you would be angry if your sibling had left for a long time, you didn't know what was going on, you didn't know if they were dead or alive or anything, and then they came back? And you found out that they were alive. Yeah, they made a few mistakes, but you found out that they were alive. And they were here. And that they had come home. How many of you would be angry about that? Right? But he is. He is angry. He's angry. And it reveals exactly why he's been working. Has he been working out of love and devotion? No. He's just as guilty because he's been working for his own inheritance too. It doesn't have anything to do with the father. It doesn't have anything to do with love. It has everything to do with him just wanting to get what he's going to get too. It just looks a lot nicer. Older son's not looking so great. Friends, there's a point in our Christian walk where we make the transition, we can make the transition from being the younger son to the older son. We like to associate ourselves with that younger son, right? We like to be the lost one that's found. We like to be the dead one that's alive. We celebrate the gospel, and rightly so. That's what Jesus has done for us. But there is a point in our lives, in our Christian walk, where there is a danger that we can make the transition from being the younger son to being the older son without even knowing it. And it's revealed in the posture that we take as a church. How we welcome those on the outside, those who aren't normally here. How we welcome those who may not necessarily look like us or act like us. How we welcome in people who don't believe but are seeking. There is a revelation that takes place when we as a church close our arms and say, we're just going to wait and see. when we don't readily welcome them, when we don't take a posture of acceptance, when we don't allow them to belong, there is something revealed about who we are as a church. And friends, we can't be that way. It is a real danger. At the end of the parable, the older son has completely missed the point of being a son, right? The father's like, I'm always with you. Everything I have is yours. Of course you're going to get your inheritance. But you've completely missed the point of being in the family. You've completely missed the point of the love that I have shown you. Because that same love goes on to the other son as well. And where the older son is angry, the younger son, the wayward son, the one where we're like, oh yeah, you know, he did, you know, did all that bad stuff, but he's forgiven. He's the one that's experiencing the true life, the true love, the true reality of what it means to be a son, the true identity that he has been given from the Father. And it begs the question, who's actually alive in this parable? Is it the older son, who's been working hard and doing his thing the whole time? Or is it the younger son? Who, yeah, he's gone astray. Yeah, he's done some things. Yeah, he probably looks a little weathered from his experiences. But when he comes home, he's experiencing the true, deep love and forgiveness of the Father. Who is actually alive in this parable? This is a dangerous question. It's a difficult question to grapple with because we want to be those who are alive, but do we think about that in the church? Who is actually alive in our community of faith? Are we really living? Are we living into this theme that Jesus says, I've come to give you life and give it and that you may have it to the full? Or are we just doing the work? We just doing the work to get our inheritance? Do we understand the heart of the Father? The Father that's always looking, always longing, wanting desperately for His Son to come home. Do we share that same heart? Or do we just put our nose to the grindstone and come here and look down and do our church thing and then go back home? That begs another question too. Who do we think belongs here? Who do we think belongs in the family? If we share the heart of the Father, the answer is a resounding everyone. Everyone belongs in the family, right? For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever would believe in Him, whoever would come to Him, would not perish but have eternal life. That's the gospel, and that's what we would believe. Of course, everyone belongs in the family. It doesn't matter whether you're red, yellow, black, or white, right? You're all precious in God's sight. The old children's song, that's probably a little bit politically incorrect now, but I mean, think about it, right? It doesn't matter what you look like. It doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter what your history is. If you've met Jesus, all of that is washed away. You belong in the family. We would say, no, we don't. It's okay. Everybody belongs here, right? Except maybe the bad people. Or no. We don't dislike bad people. We just want them to dress up like good people when they come here. We want them to look like us and sound like us and act like us. We don't want them to ask difficult questions. We want to be safe. We want to be sound. We want to be secure. Is that the danger that we're facing? Is that the danger that we face? It begs the question. Now, please remember, this isn't condemning. Not condemning anyone here. Scripture says there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But it could be convicting. It could be a little bit convicting to us as individuals. It could be a little bit convicting to us as the community of faith here at Hopkins Community Church. That maybe we're running the risk of being a little bit more like the older son. Remember the crowd? Crowd that Jesus is talking to. So there's sinners and tax collectors, right? And they're labeled as such. They know their place. And then there's the Pharisees and the teachers of the law and stuff. And they're very sure about their place. They know exactly. You know, they're the righteous people. They stand up straight. They're the ones that judge and do all of this judging. And they make sure that people know their place and stay in their place. Do we do that here? Do we do that in our own lives? Are we a church that is empathy and compassion first, and opinion and judgment last? Or have we mixed that up a little bit? Are we, as individuals, those who are opinion first and judgment first, or compassion first and empathy first? I've been picking on social media, and I think it has the right to be picked on because of what it's become in the last couple of years. But if you think about it, if you think about how we represent ourselves as Christians, as people of God, as people who are seeking, as people who are dead and made alive, are the things that we post on social media things that are judgment first and opinion first, or are they empathy first and compassion first? Do they reveal the heart of the Father in us? Or do they reveal the barriers that we want to place? The fact that, yeah, sure, we like bad people, but we want them to dress up like good people. Does it reveal something about ourselves? And I'm not condemning, but this could be convicting. It could be really convicting because Facebook is a mess right now. If you are on Facebook, like, it's like get off Facebook kind of time, right? Because we get caught up in all this stuff. And we have the danger of being more like the older son. One other question I think that this parable raises. What are we celebrating here? There's two celebrations that are suggested in this parable. There's the celebration that happens when the younger son comes home. We kill the fattened calf. He's got all the great clothes and the ring and everything else. Like, these are all symbols of honor and stuff like that. The younger son is being celebrated because he was dead and he's made alive. What are we celebrating here? Are we celebrating that here in this place, dead people are being made alive? The gospel is being proclaimed. People are coming to know Jesus. Or are we just taking that young goat with our friends and hanging out and having a good time? Do we celebrate that God is on the move, that lost people are being found, that dead people are being made alive? Do we celebrate this here? This is our celebration. When we come together in worship, this is our celebration. Don't be deceived. This is what we celebrate. We celebrate the gospel. We remember the gospel. All of what we do here is about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And the gospel isn't about making bad people good. It's about making dead people alive. We've said this before. We'll say it again and again and again and again. That we're not here just to work hard and be good little workers and then ask for our inheritance at the end of our lives. We're here because God has called us and then called us to find the lost sheep, to find the lost. The people in Hopkins, in Door, in Shelbyville, in Wayland, in Allegan, that don't know Jesus, that have gone out from their Father. Are we celebrating that here? Or are we just having a little celebration with our friends? Because if we're having just a little celebration with our friends, then what we're guilty of is doing church together. We're just doing church. We come here every Sunday. It feels good. We go home. We check it off the list, and life is good. We're done. We're done for the week. But if we're celebrating the gospel of Jesus Christ, it is infectious, it is transformative, and it sends us out to go find more lost sheep and bring them back here so we can celebrate together that God is on the move, that God is doing work, and that dead people are being made alive. I don't want to just do church. That's empty. It's fruitless. It's just going through the motions. If we're going to be a church where people can belong and come to belief and then become all that God has created them to be, that's the trajectory of the sermons here. Spoiler alert, that's where we're going. If we're going to do that, We need to be about the celebration of the Father, celebrating that younger son every single Sunday. Can I get an amen? Thank you. You can say that more often. It's all right. Unless I'm not making sense. And in which case, just say, shh, shh. Pastor, done. You're done. When we come to the table here, that's what this celebration is about. It's a celebration that together we have been called. Together we were once lost and now we're found. We were once dead and are made alive. That's what Ephesians says. All of you lived among them at one time, gratifying the desires of your sinful nature. You were by nature objects of wrath. But because of His great love for us, God made us alive in Christ, even though we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved, and it is because of grace that you are welcome here. And so we celebrate that now as we come to the table, that God has welcomed us. Those who are sinners, those who are unworthy, but by grace we have been saved. Let's pray. Lord, there are not words to adequately express our thankfulness to you for what you've done for us. Because we know ourselves. We know the things that go on in our heads. You know the things that go on in our heads. And we know that we are not worthy, but because of your Son, by your grace, we are welcome at your table to feast and to celebrate with you. Because you found us and you have made us alive in Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, as we come to this table right now, pray that you would help us to remember that. That you would encourage us, that you would embolden us, that you would strengthen us, that you would show us once again your love. That we would meet you here in that unique and mysterious way that you meet us here. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you for your Son, Jesus. Thank you that you are always with us, that you never leave us, that you never forsake us, that you walk with us, that you have shown us your love. Thank you for your Spirit, Lord, that is constantly and always working inside of us to build us up into the image of your Son. Speak now, again, Lord, in this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to celebrate. We're going to celebrate because we were once lost and now we were found. And we're going to do that by coming to the table. Because Jesus calls us to the table, his table. On the night the Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took bread with his disciples. He gave thanks and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you eat it, remember me." In the same manner, after they had eaten, he took the cup and he poured it out, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the sins of all people. As often as you drink it, remember me. This morning we're going to do something a little bit different, maybe a little bit outside of our norm. We're going to have communion intinction style, which means you're going to come forward, you're going to dip a little bit, take a piece of bread, rip it off, take a piece of bread. Don't take a crumb of bread. Take a piece of bread. This is a feast. Take a piece of bread, rip it off. We're going to dip it in the cup and eat it up here. So if we'll just have you kind of come up in rows. If you're unable to get up here. We recognize that that's not easy for everyone. If you're unable to get up here after everyone has come forward, we will kind of walk out front, and if you could just raise your hand. If you weren't able to make it up, just kind of raise your hand. We will come to you. because that's what God does. He comes to us no matter where we are, no matter what we're going through. That's what God does. That's the posture that God has. He searches us out. And so whatever happens, if you can't make it up here, we'll come to you. Just give us a little hand wave so we know where we're going. I invite the elders to come forward. Come, for all things are ready.
something I forgot to say about the table. If you believe Jesus Christ is your Savior, you are welcome here. You don't have to be a member of this community. You don't have to be a member of this church. You could be here for the first time, and it's okay. If you believe that Jesus is your Savior, you are welcome here. So if you didn't come up for some reason, you're welcome. And we would love to come to you.
That awkward moment when we didn't plan things very well. We're waiting for two guys to come back. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful. We thank you for welcoming us to your table. We thank you for the grace and the mercy that you show us each day. And God, we pray that as this food strengthens us and nourishes us physically, that your Spirit would nourish us and strengthen us in our lives, that you would nourish our souls, Lord, that you would build us up and continue to do that good work in us. Thank you, Father, for your Son. Thank you that you didn't leave us to the things that we deserve, Lord, but that you have welcomed us with open arms, that you come running to us to embrace us, to celebrate that we have been made alive, that you did that for us, knowing that we could never do it for ourselves. Father, we thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. So we come to the table of celebration, but we never stay here. Never stay here. We don't come in and feast and feast and feast and feast and just stay here at the table. One of the biggest themes, one of the greatest themes of this event, this celebration, is actually the point at which we leave. And we don't just walk away, we are sent. Sent out. Jesus invites us here. He welcomes us here, but he sends us out saying, go and find the lost sheep and bring them here. We want more people here because my body's not complete yet. My bride is not complete yet. We're not whole. And so as we leave this table, as we leave this worship space, we are sent out to go and find the lost sheep and to bring them back. Bring them back into the fold, so that we can celebrate together with them that the lost are being found, that the dead are being raised.